Any Tommy Rovers supporters here? Yes, good lad. There's always one. Just very quickly, unlike most people who will talk to you in sport, I haven't got a load of slides. And actually, that's quite bad news, because actually sport can provide a lot of good material. You know, I can have video feedbacks of players scoring goals, etc., etc. I haven't got that today, so you're going to have to make do with me just talking to you. So apologies up front on that one. Just a little bit about my background to give me some credentials with you, because you probably don't know me, but you may have heard of Tranmere Rovers Football Club. I was a professional footballer for 17 years. I have a degree in psychology from Manchester. I am also a qualified chartered accountant. I used to be the UK and European leader for business regeneration for PwC. If you don't know what PwC is, they're the people who couldn't get it right at the Oscars, which you may have seen last week, but they're the biggest accountancy firm and consultancy firm in that way in the world. In addition to that, I was the chief executive of the Football Association, responsible for building Wembley and various other things, changing our disciplinary process, etc., etc., and for bringing in age-specific coaching into the UK, which is relevant to what I'm doing today with Tranmere. I then worked as a consultant in the City of London, fixing businesses. I wrote the strategy for Cubas and Lybrand, and I actually developed the approach to turnaround in this country, which is fixing businesses. So I've got a background in business. If you want to feed off that, you can do. And then about 2.5 years ago, my wife and I bought Tranmere Rovers, so I'm the executive chairman of Tranmere Rovers. And the reason for that was quite simple. Tranmere Rovers were on the decline. The day that we got relegated out of League One, I said we'll get relegated down to out of the league itself, which unfortunately came true just over a year ago. And that was it. We'd go into administration. Well, that's my job, was fixing businesses. My wife said, "And blokes, this is what you should get to the point whereby you can persuade your wife that it was all her idea." And she said, "Yeah, why don't you go and fix it?" And I said, "I would if you would." And she is now the vice chairman of the club. So I work with my wife, which is, again, an interesting situation. That's my background. And what I want to do is talk a little bit about what we're doing at Tranmere Rovers. If you've got any questions coming off your management course, then I'm happy to take some questions on that. I mean, don't feel inhibited by what I've just said about myself. I'm actually relatively approachable. I understand exactly where you are, because when I was a student at university, I didn't have a clue about half the things I've just spoken about then, the things I learned and picked up on the way. So I don't expect you to understand what the return on capital is, etc., etc., etc. That's all stuff that we can... You'll get to eventually if you're boring enough to become an accountant. Tranmere, in terms of the way I do turnarounds and the way I got PwC to do turnarounds, there's three stages. The first stage is to create a breathing space. The second stage is to use that breathing space to fix the business, fix the way it operates. And the third phase is usually to get investment in. Tranmere are part of the way through the second phase, and I'm looking for investment now to complete the third phase. What that means is that when you start, if you're looking at a business, and a lot of people talk about restructuring a business, they talk about changing the balance sheet. If I'm getting too technical, just put your hand up and I'll stop. The balance sheet is what assets you've got, what liabilities you've got. And so they change that by writing off debt. Like Greece, they're trying to write off debt. They never write off enough. And they'll give you, if you take the gambler's fallacy, they will give the gamblers at the table, they give him, are you a Greek lad?
Yeah.
Tikanis kala?
Yeah,
kala. Yes, ne kala. Just get that out of the way. Then he left that. He's not that Greek, that's what we find out. So the actual, the gamblers at the table, and all you do is you turn up, you give him some more cash, he has the same game plan as before, and surprise, surprise, he loses it. So you just give him another go. So if you only fix the balance sheet, which is what you do to give yourself more time, you give the club more money, we wrote off debt, we put some cash in, then if you don't change the way it does business, you'll eventually lose it. So, you know, Tranmere were making £1 million loss. It doesn't sound a lot to people, but actually to a club like Tranmere, it is a loss. And that has to be put in every year. And so we set about fixing that. So what you do is you fix the business, you fix the profit and loss account so that you get rid of the loss. You change the game plan for the gambler so he isn't just betting black, red, black, red, black, red all the time. And in fixing the business at Tranmere, this is where you get to a position of looking at what you can do with the business that you've got. So it's realising the potential of the business. It's saying, what assets have we got and do we fully utilise the assets? When I walked into Tranmere, it used to be painful because every day I'd walk into the ground at Prenton Park and know that it was costing me £1 million because we were doing nothing with it. And over the course of the last 2 years, we've been trying to change that business model. And I'll just go through some of those changes, because when I'm talking about these changes, you'll see hopefully that whilst you look at a football club, it isn't what you think it is. Well, lots of them are, which is why they're in trouble, but it's what it can be in terms of the different businesses that are already in that club. And if you're coming on as a secondment to a club like Tranmere Rovers, and one thing I would say is there are different animals. The Premier League clubs are entirely different to the lower league clubs. And that's an important point to bear in mind. And sometimes you can get positions in a Premier League club which you're so removed from the reality, it's untrue. And I'd always say, yeah, get a position in a lower league club, providing it's got the steerage at the top to be doing the things that make it interesting. But so if you're looking at Tranmere, I said we're going to realise the potential. What is realising the potential about? That's about doing things like, for old common sense things, non-match day income. You know, you sit there with a stadium that's not used for probably 13 days out of 14 for 9 months of the year. The other 3 months it's not used at all. So you immediately start saying, well, actually, can we use this? So how do we start using it? We started off in the close season, the first season we were there, the end of that close season, we changed all the rooms. We invested in the rooms. So now we've built up a business around that conference and events business that provides jobs for people, which fits in with our community, which I'll come back to. So, you know, we had, when we went there, the first Christmas, there was nobody came for a Christmas party at Tranmere, because you wouldn't do it. The second Christmas, we had 400 people come for a Christmas party. Timing-wise, you could only do that in the close season, which is August-ish, July, August, change the rooms. You couldn't market till September, so I didn't expect to change, you know, the way people went for Christmas parties on the world. So we had 400 people. So that wasn't bad. Last year we had 2,500 people come for that. So immediately you're starting to use the assets. On a match day, they made losses. The accounting systems were crap. Am I allowed to say that here? Yeah. Well, you've heard worse than that. The accounting systems were crap. And as a consequence, they didn't even know they were making losses on the food. Come in, 2-0 down. They didn't know we were making losses on the food. Changing accounting systems, changing the quality of the food, we charge for the food, and the profitability around that particular aspect of the match day has improved as well. Moving on to other assets that we used, shop, for example. I think when we went in, the shop was earning about £100,000. We changed the shop. We got Puma to invest. We changed the kit to Puma, so it was a lot more fashion friendly, shall I say, than JD Sports. You may tell me I'm wrong on this, but looking around the room, you should come and have a look at our Puma stuff. It's good. And the Puma change, the change of the shop, the fact that we made people not queue in the car park at a quarter cabin for their tickets, but actually queue in the shop. You go through an airport, you're forced to go through duty free. Well, now if you want to pick up your tickets, you're forced to go through our shop. And the turnover's turned from £100,000 to £300,000. Using the assets that we've got and making the most of the potential. There's a variety of other things that we did. I won't mention them all, but one of the big things, and this is where you look at the way sport should be viewed generally and more broadly than it's football or it's athletics. Sorry, I was also a director of British Judo, and I'm on the Audit, Risk and Governance Committee of Surrey County Cricket Club, so I've looked across a whole range of sports as well. And sport itself is a massive vehicle for doing things. Today in The Guardian, Tranmere have been commended for stuff we've done on the community side, and somebody who's got back into work, not being able to work. about 2 years ago, my father would have turned in his grave, but I was mentioned in Hansard's in the House of Lords because we'd done stuff with the disabled supporters that other Premier League clubs aren't doing. Community is a massive part of the club at Tranmere. And the two thrusts of what we're going to do to turn the club around are, one, apart from using all the assets, one is to be a development club to develop players, because we've always done that. Our under-16s now are the national champions for the academies at Category 3 level. And Cresswell's an ex-England is an ex-Tranmere player. He's just got his England debut, etc. We've always produced players. I was a poor example of the players that they produced, but since then they've improved it a little bit. So the club can develop because it's in this area here, and it's got this as a major catchment area. The second element has been a community club. And just coming back to using our assets, we can attract kids, we can attract disadvantaged people in a way that other institutions can't. So, LJMU, well-respected organisation, absolutely no bearing whatsoever to the 12, 13-year-old kid on the street who won't go to school in Toxteth or in the Woodchurch, etc. Whereas the club can access that, and that accessibility, we get money for it. We will now make a profit this year at least of about $250,000 from what we do in terms of our community business. We have a college, which again, you look at how the club works. We have a college which was set up by a guy who spent 12 years in prison as a drug dealer. And he was a Liverpool schoolboy, and he, like most of the kids who come to football clubs, I think 99% fail to make it as a professional footballer. And of his year, six, one made it as a pro, and six ended up in jail. And that's part of the, so he came to us with an idea. We set up our college. Our college had 26 lads in it last year. We give them BTECs in sport, we give them BTECs in construction, and then we also train them as footballers. 16 of those have now gone out to play for semi-professional clubs in the leagues below us. This year we got 66 kids, next year we'll have 90 odd. And for every kid we get, at the moment, £3,200. We can get 4,000 if we become a main contractor. So if you're starting to look at this as a football club, you look at it as a slightly different animal with lots of different business streams. And I'm not going to go through everything that we've done on this, because I'm going to invite you to ask me some questions if you like. But one of the biggest things I'd like to talk about is what we're doing in China. And you say, what on earth is Tranmere Rovers doing in China? And the answer is, initially, we were exporting teachers to a university called Honda University, and they were going to send kids over to us. So we'd use our assets. We would use our training facilities in the summer, and they'd be sending Chinese kids over to us for football-based holidays in the UK. What happened was that the Inner Mongolian government, because this is based in Inner Mongolia, whole hot, and I tell you what, has anybody here been to China? I guess you might. How? Do you know where Ho Hot is? Ho Hot. It's a capital of Inner Mongolia. There you go. I didn't know either. But when I went to China, because my daughter was teaching English out there, I realised how big it was. And I thought, well, actually, everybody's going to Shanghai. Everybody's going to Beijing. Everybody's going to Guangzhou. And everybody's focused on the Premier League out there and all the players out there. Why don't we look at grassroots? Because no professional club's interested in grassroots. Well, I know my background at the FA means I've probably thought about it earlier than most others. And why don't, and when this opportunity came up in Inner Mongolia, I thought, well, that's going to be a big place as well. There's 3 million people in Ho Hot. And then a piece of luck. You always need a bit of luck in the game. Inner Mongolia was designated, and I didn't know this at the time, two years ago, as the principal province for the development of football in China. So it's the pilot province for the development of football in China. Ho Hot is now the first football city in China. And when we were out there developing our relationship with the school, in terms of sending teachers out there, which they pay us for, I won't go into the detail of why they asked us to do it, but that's what we went out for. The Inner Mongolian government latched onto the fact that I was out there, and that was last September. What developed from that was basically the educationalist who sets up schools, and if you're looking at setting up a business, you see what the core competency of that business is. This guy sets up schools for fun. He's got a university out there with 10,000 students, and he's a private university, and he's got 10 English-speaking private schools, and he's got another 10,000 students in that, in this one city. So he said, do you want to set up a football school? So we said, yes. We have a 45% stake in a football school, which we opened last week when I was out in China. Relevant to jobs for the people here in the UK. In addition to that, the Inner Mongolian government has asked us to help them develop football. So Little Tommy Rovers is helping them to develop football. So we signed a memorandum of understanding with the government for 3 years last week. We've already had coaches over from Inner Mongolia, which we trained about a month ago, and they're delighted with the quality of the work, the certification. The FA let me give them international certificates. But uniquely, we actually put the certification together with the access to a professional club. So where it stands at the moment is we will be identifying the top talent. We've got to send scouts out to look at the top talent in Inner Mongolia. We will be developing their whole system of coaching the coaches. We'll be developing their system of training their elite talent. And they'll be sending over, and the vice chairman of the Communist Party in Inner Mongolia, who ended up being my arm wrestling champion at a dinner, and it's another thing I do in business in China, which I can explain at some other stage. He said yesterday that we would get 300 to come over here. Now, we may wait between 1,000 to 1,500 on each coach, which the mathematicians amongst you will say goes a long way towards that loss I was talking about when we walked through the door. And that's just the Inner Mongolian government kids and coaches coming over to England onto the world in our new training complex at Solar Campus. Already you'll see that there's a massive breadth to what we do, and it isn't just a little non-league club, which unfortunately we are in the non-league as we stand today, but all this goes to creating the future. So off the back of all of this work, we then start to get to the third phase, which is to ask for investment into the club. And then we are asking for investment. We talked to the Chinese about investment. They're interested in investing. And that will happen over the next 6 to 12 months. And in the meantime, why bother with Tranmere Rovers? And the answer is nobody has ever defined self-sustainability for a football club. Well, I have. Self-sustainability is quite simple to me. We have a top third budget in whatever league we play in, and we break even. Your discretionary spend is always your player's budget. If you've got a top third budget with better than average support systems, your sports science, your scouting, your talent ID, all of the systems there that underpin that, then average luck, you'll be in the top third. So you'll be always around the playoffs. If you're always around the playoffs in every league, then you'll be maximizing your gates because there's an interest in your season. You're not fighting relegation. So top third budget in whatever league you play in, underpinned with better than average support systems, break even. That's self-sustainability. Now, if we'd gone up last year, which we missed out by a point from the playoffs, then we would have been more than self-sustainable in the Football League because of the way the funding comes out of the Football League. So we ain't that far off. We need to get promoted. There's lots of work still to do to continue to increase the potential that's out there. And whatever happens, we keep the same business plan and we keep going. That is Tranmere. If there's too much detail in there, I apologise. Would any of you like to ask any questions? Feel free.
You know, you said about you changed like your shop and your merchandise. How did you get Puma to invest? Puma, is that established brand?
Yeah, it's a good question. One of the things I had to do was to stop everybody feeling sorry for themselves. And one of the ways you do that is you pump up the confidence. And the day that we went down, I and again, this is about PR. It is, and I did a reasonable amount of media stuff when I was at PwC, and I was trained to do that, and I was at the FA, so I know what it's like. And so I actually planned for a week before we went down what I was going to say. And the phrase I used at the time was, it's devastating today, which it was when we went down, but it's not disastrous tomorrow. I like alliteration. And that little phrase was all about keeping the enthusiasm around the club, which is massive. Our gates have held up since we've gone down, in fact increased our season ticket. So part of that goodwill factor was determined around, well, let's have a look at making ourselves feel like a big club. And we went straight out to Puma and we said, look, you know, and these are all the good things about the club. Yeah, we've come down. Yeah, it's fine. I understand that. It's not fine, but, you know, we'll deal with it. And by the way, we think we can increase the merchandising. Now, Puma, still being a big brand, are still keen to sell because they've got massive competition. And they looked at us and thought, yeah, no, we can see that. And so what they did is they then funded over 3 years the majority of the restructuring we did, because we actually changed the club shop physically. And so they funded that. And in return, we had an agreement with them whereby we will then sell X shirts for Y pounds. And you know, we got the kit, et cetera, for a variety of teams as well. So for them, it was a commercial decision. I think the key thing was not to internally almost do what you did then, which is say, well, why Tranmere?
Yeah.
You know, my view is, why not Tranmere? You know, because we've got like 5,000 people coming every week. Where'd you get that? They buy new shirts, they buy away shirts. Our sales have gone up. But in addition to that, it was the quality of the merchandise around the leisurewear gear, etc. And actually, it was an important statement to the fans. You know, you had the Puma brand on. I apologise if anybody's got a shitty JD brand on, but suddenly they were buying it to walk around in the streets. And that helps us because they're out there advertising the club immediately. So it's all about the positive attitude that you can give to the club. And you know, self-limiting beliefs, massive. I'll say that when I talk about when you're working in business, there's some standard things that everybody I think should carry around with them. One is, you know, get beyond your self-limiting beliefs. If you think you're a non-league club, you'll become a non-league club. If you think you can't do the job, you won't do the job. You know, so it's all about bigging yourself up, but delivering. You've got to deliver, and we could deliver. Anybody else want a lecture? How does it relate to your management course that you've just had? Pun? It's all right. Okay is not okay, that's another thing. No, I think it's difficult because I imagine where you are. You know, you don't know what a P&L is compared to a balance sheet, compared to this and that and the other. I think the only thing I want to get across is that, you know, this as an organisation couldn't stay where it was. And actually, if you had self-limiting beliefs as the organisation, it would have stayed where it was. And one of the big things was to keep the collective positivity around the place. And you're a Tranmere fan. I mean, I know it's a dangerous question to ask because I don't know the answer to it. Is there a positivity around the club?
At the moment, yeah, because form's not been bad. Like last season, it was positivity was quite down with like the people I know around it. Anyway, but this year is a lot more of a belief, especially with the trophy run as well. Like that, I think that's given a lot of positivity.
Yeah, that's interesting. If I had a choice, I mean, I wouldn't be in the trophy. Because you just distract, you get injuries and so forth. But the reality is that, you know, our season tickets went up. I actually put the prices up when we went down and the season tickets went up.
Which trophy is that?
Sorry?
Which trophy is it?
There's a non-league FA Cup called the FA Trophy. Sorry? The fans at Wembley, and you know, the lads makes it, sorry, not your name, makes a good point. And I've seen it happen in front of me, you know, you haven't got all the answers. And that is that there's a massive positivity about the fact that we could be going to Wembley. You know, and it's a day out for the fans. And that again uplifts the whole club again. It's the sort of the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, keeps the momentum going.
Why is it you're against the non-league trophy?
If you'd asked me at the start of the season, I'd have said, you know, if we went out the trophy, I'd have gone. Because we don't get injuries. We lost 4 first team players 2 weeks ago within 8 days. You know, and the size we happen to have, we focused on having a big squad and a strong squad just for this eventuality. So we can handle it. But the reality is that on balance, you know, it's almost like where the FA Cup was treated by Premier League clubs. But for us, it's massively important because it's a day out at Wembley. We could actually have two. If we're in the playoffs, we could be in the playoff final as well. So that'll be great. All adds to the atmosphere around the club. So it's not a massive money spinner for us.
What's the average salary, for a Premier player? What's the other week?
Some of them would be on, before bonuses, 80 grand, 90 grand.
Yeah.
Yeah. And some of them, the more junior ones, would be on down to 25, 30.
Yeah. As we even like the lower players, you know, it's still like a sort of, you can live just off that.
Well, when kids come out of university, they won't be getting that. And they get bonuses as well. We only get win bonuses. You get nothing for the draw and stuff like that. So, you know, it's a great life if you can have it. I mean, I played in the lower leagues for, not in the non-league, but in the actual football league, but, you know, it was a good life. You know, I happened to do all the stuff at the same time, but it was a good life. Anything else on the club? What we're doing?
What community work do you do?
Sorry?
What community work do you do?
What community work? We have the college. We have a recreation centre which is alongside the ground, and we use that principally for a whole variety of stuff, ranging from stuff that we get paid for by the local council. They've given us money to get people back into work or get them into a position whereby, you know, they've got a chance to get a job. In fact, there's an article in The Guardian today. If you want to read that, you'll see that. The college itself is relatively, it's community work. Again, it's lads who falling out of education. We started with lads who have fallen out of other academies, and, you know, and this massive downer because they're suddenly not going to be a professional footballer, and getting them back on track and getting them with a trade and so forth. But we get paid for that. It ranges down to complete charitable work. And one of the things I did in terms of leveraging the brand was, I called it SWA2, like a postcode. It's the next destination. It's the next generation of fans, because we have to get fans in. Get a fan between 5 and 10, we'll keep them. Don't care about Liverpool, Everton, we'll keep them. And I was also in the foster home when I was a kid, so I recognised this, whereby kids couldn't go to a club. They could never go and see a football game. And one of the advantages we have over Liverpool and Everton is affordable live football. And, you know, lots of kids now just see it on a screen or on the television and actually can't get to a game. But these were other kids that weren't reached, who were sitting in foster homes and sitting in families whereby they didn't have the cash to pay for a kid to go to a game. And it just occurred to me season before last, when some of our season ticket holders who couldn't come said, look, we can't come, but we'll pay for a season ticket, send it to a good cause. And I thought, wow, catch the wind. And I got 3,000 quid from the players when we did the bonus negotiations. I said, well, by the way, give us 100 season tickets for kids, which is about 30 quid. It's nothing. So we got 3,000. I got the trust to give us 3,000 quid. I got the supporters club to give us 3,000 quid. By the way, we've set up the trust and the supporters club. In other clubs, they fight with the club. We'd always they work with us. And that was 10,000 quid. And that means that we can then bring kids in. So we again, they gave the tickets out to the agencies, social workers, to local politicians, again, massive, because they could then go out and make sure that the right people in their community, whom they would know, would come to a game. And we got some great quotes from the kids and from the carers. And that's grown. It's grown now to the extent that this year, I think, we're targeting 20,000 quid for tickets. Now, these are free tickets. Some of these kids, you know, strategically, you wouldn't target them because they may not be the best in the future in terms of having cash in their pockets. But it doesn't really matter because, you know, they're coming, they're seeing Tramway. Lots of them are sticking as it happens. But I remember I got to the cup final by some guy who knew my situation, and he actually arranged for me to have a ticket to go to the cup in 1967, and I never forgot that. And that, the actual impact of that was phenomenal, both because we suddenly created goodwill with all of the councillors and the council, who are important to us because they create the context within which we live. They'll give us planning, they'll help us out with this, they'll help us out with that. And so it has massive benefits. And then for our fans itself, you know, it was a focus for them. Again, using the assets of the club, the people outside and the fans, all the goodwill was then focused through the club and then out into these kids where some good was done. But hey ho, never cost me a penny. It was your money, it was your money. And the kids were getting the benefit and the club was getting the kudos from it. And then we moved it to, we play in all whites, so we are known as the Super White Army, which, you know, isn't politically correct, I guess, but it's what we are. And so we when I first came here, Radio City used to collect all of the toys and have a toy appeal, and we'd collect them through the club. I said, well, we'll do our own. So we collected last year, and we called it the Super White Christmas, and we collected all the toys, and we provided hampers, etc. And again, there's lots of needy families, and so for Christmas they actually had hampers, they had toys for the kids, etc. And this year, I can't forget the full amount, but we doubled it in size, and we also had meals on Christmas Day for the homeless, for lonely people, and then on the Boxing Day we had for homeless people as well. Now, you may say, what's that got to do with the football? It's massive. Massive. Because if I broke even on community, it is the best way to market your club across the water in the world. And, you know, but I don't intend to break even. Those are particular charitable things that we do. There's lots of other stuff that we do. The mental health, of course, will then pay us to look after people. Not look after them, but to get them on a way whereby they're more self-sufficient, etc. And so there's lots of these grants that are coming in. And again, the people at the club are fantastic, and we have a reputation now of delivering. It's one of my big things. It's deliver. You've got to deliver, and so we've done that, and that just grows from strength to strength. I came out this morning, and somebody said to me, "We've got a contract with HND, so we'll be delivering HND courses for kids." Again, it's the ones that aren't conventional. It's the ones that are just on the edges and the fringes, but they'll come to a football club because it's a football club. How do I engage with fans during matches?
Yeah.
I tell them to piss off. No, how do you engage with fans is a good, can I broaden your question out?
Yeah.
Come on. There is the matches, but I think it's how you engage with fans that's the bigger thing. What stunned me when I was chief exec of the FA was the times where you had the supporters fighting the clubs. But when you think about it logically, you're both after the same thing. You're after the good of the club. So I came along, and the club had been in decline for many years. And I just told them as it is. I said, well, we've got to do this, we've got to do that. And so there's a honeymoon period. And you come along and they say, yeah, that's fine. He's a new guy, and he's an ex-player, and he's going to do the right thing, supposedly. But the first thing I did was to get hold of there's a supporters trust at the club. I'm massively overrunning here, aren't I?
It's all right. Well, you're all about to
catch a plane. Yeah, I've got to catch a plane, yeah. But the supporters' trust was massively important. Now, the supporters' trust at most clubs fight the club because they think they can do it better than the people who own the club. And some, yeah, probably the majority of cases, I'd say they can. And I just thought, I said, look, you know, your aim is the same as mine. I said, well, tell you what, let's start with the maths. How much can you raise? You want to buy the club, because they were trying to buy the club off the previous owner. And they went, oh, we can get £500,000. So that's great. So we make a loss of £1 million. So that gives you 6 months. Good luck. And the conversation ends there. So it immediately kills the argument that the fans should own the club. So you can't afford it unless you want to massively reduce your playing budget, in which case, you know, bye-bye. So they were on side because of that. And then I invited the trust onto the, I had nothing to hide. You know, tell me I'm wrong on the figures. Tell me I'm wrong on this or wrong on that. We'll have a debate. And so I invited the trust onto the board. And we don't really have a board in a conventional sense, because it's only me and my wife, and we own the club. But we share everything with them. Now, you've got to make sure that there's confidentialities. And these guys have been confidential. So yesterday, for example, we're setting the season ticket policy for next year, and we consult with them. So we had, and we took some points on board and we changed it. So there's a real meaningful dialogue with the trust. They will contribute £25,000 a year, £30,000 a year on various projects. I don't direct them on the projects, but they discuss them with us, and there's a real relationship built. But that's a small element of the fan base, and I was aware of that. What I was keen to do was to expand it out to the rank and file supporters. So last year we set up a supporters club, an official supporters club. It's not a creature of the club. They operate, they cooperate with us, and you know, they were trying to run an away scheme, point scheme, which, you know, yesterday we might think we might scrap that, but they've been positively involved and brought into the club. And also about a month ago, there's a very influential, or potentially influential, group of supporters around London. And you know, so I went down for the opening of that. So we're setting up geographical caucuses, like there's one in the northeast wants to set up. You know, so once you've got that, you've got the ability to communicate with lots of fans in a way that you wouldn't do if you just went out with fans. That's one aspect to it. And that's a more structural aspect to the way I'm approaching that. In addition to that, social media, massive. I mean, I'm well gone past the days of social media. I hate it. And I think I've tweeted about 12 times. I think six of them is because my fingers hit the wrong button. And I always start mine off, but I don't do tweets, but I'll tweet on something significant. You know, like, you know, if when we beat Barrow, best turnaround ever. We were down at Barrow last season, and in the 89th minute, we were 3-1 down. And at this particular point, guy, chaps, this is when it turns. My wife's sitting next to me, she's got her head in her hands, and it's back to it's all my idea that we came down. In the 95th minute, when we were winning 4-3, it was all her idea again. And I tweeted after that one. So the social media is very important, and this is where you guys can possibly find jobs, because communication, you know, and actually you're probably all past it now, because my 14-year-old daughter's probably onto different things now in terms of how we communicate. Massively important, and my wife does all the social media. I hate it, but she will therefore communicate. And that's been a big, it's a big, big factor in our ability to communicate with the fans. And more important, there's a phrase I use, which perception is reality. If they perceive we are communicating with them, then that's the reality of it. And so the very fact that this is relatively high profile and we seem to respond, and we do try to respond to various things when it comes in, then this is a level of communication the fans haven't had. And that's part of the reason why the relationship with the fans is pretty good. You've constantly got to work at that. The other, because what happens is, I mean, I don't really do social media, but I will look at it. And just like when I was at the FA, I always say, oh, they used to bring me in the papers, and you may not know this, but the number of comments about the FA is the same as the three. There's Downing Street, Buckingham Palace, and the FA, and everybody else is over here. And, you know, you've got to be cognizant of what's being said, but not a slave to it. And there's a big difference between the two. So I will filter through and check what's going on. But communicating with the fans, formal structures, informal social media, and you can be massively innovative around that. But that's where there's a whole host of jobs for you to do. There really is. And some of the digital stuff that's coming out now is fantastic. You know, our shop, we talked about our shop. We work with an organisation who's, again, he's a fan. He does lots of stuff with the schools. The schools is one of our channels to market, you know, the young kids. And what popped up on my desk the other day, and you may say, well, you know all about this, but the new shop we were talking about, you can actually now go online on our new shop, and you can travel around the shop, and you can click on something on the shelf and order it. I just thought, fantastic. Great. Just don't show my wife that. But it's a massive, massive aspect, the communication with fans. And it's an art, not a science. But you use the new media that you can use. Anything else, guys? I'll talk a little bit about what you look for in an employee and getting jobs in sport. Otherwise, I'm happy to take any more questions on the football club if you want.
Yeah,
that's relevant to you. Marketing. Think of all the things. What's a club about? What's a business about? Yeah, there's marketing. Yeah, there's HR. Yeah, there's accountancy. Don't see anybody here particularly wants to do accountancy, but the numbers are, they tell a story to me, so I'm anal about it. There's the technical side. There's the sports science. There's nutrition we have in the club. We have lots of people from the LJMU department. We have nutritionists, you've got physiotherapists, you've got sports scientists generally in terms of strength and conditioning, etc. You've got analysis, which is the big, big thing, analysis. And we increasingly use that. All our guys, analysis in terms of prepping for the games, you know, what the opposition do, where we lost the ball in terms of the part of the field that we lost the ball, how many, you know, corners we had and where the pressure came from, and again, all that type of stuff is done in detail. And actually, if you're a football nut, it's quite interesting stuff to do. What are the jobs? There's logistics, there's operations. It's just like a normal business in that regard. There's lots of things that can be done within the organisation.
You copied Everton or Liverpool on anything?
Yeah, we lose at home too often. Yeah, I think the thing is that the thing is that the answer is Everton. I mean, I sit on the Northwest Football Awards, and I've done as a judge for many years. And Everton are always far ahead of anybody in terms of their community work. So I looked at what they were doing. We're doing things slightly differently, and I would argue for our size, we have a bigger bang for our buck than they do in terms of the community. But their community work is excellent. Liverpool, not so much. Liverpool is where we probably have the best relationship, if I'm honest. And around our academy, for example, one of our young lads will travel, I've just agreed that he'll go to Liverpool's academy. And so our relationship with Liverpool's is better in terms of that. Where we are at the moment, and I had a conversation with Klopp and with Alex Inglethorpe, who runs the academy, last night. We need to step up another, we need to get back in the league. And then the differential between loaning kids out to us, and we wouldn't necessarily have a lot of the kids. My personal view is that the ECCC system, which is the academy system we've got now, is over-engineered and doesn't work. And so we can't find, if you play Liverpool's under 23s, you won't be able to come and play even in the National League necessarily. You might struggle. And so you've got to be very careful about loaning players in and out. And also they, you know, you've got to have a similar approach to the way you train them, etc. Now we have a great facility at Solar Campus, which we opened in December, really. So we'll increasingly do stuff with them. But it is a different animal. And if I just talk about China again briefly, that's a classic example of that. So why would Liverpool be interested in China? They'd be interested in China for eyeballs, you know, because if they can get eyeballs on their games, if they can get eyeballs on their, they can then get fans who buy their kits. So it's all about merchandising. It's all about, if you want to sponsor Liverpool as, you know, whoever their sponsor, I can't remember their sponsors are, but if you want to sponsor them on a shirt, well, actually, if you've got the whole television population of China watching it, then it's worth a lot more than if not. So they're after that type, those aspects. They're not after what we're after, which is, well, let's just help you develop your football. So it's difficult to mirror them. Let's put it this way. If we, our turnover in League One, when I came, League One, was 3.8 million. 300 of that shouldn't have been in there, so say 3.5. Taking out player sales, which was, you know, they're up and down. The turnover for that club in League One was 1.5 million, roughly. Our turnover in the National League, excluding player sales this season, will be 6 million. When that's out the league, down two leagues and four times what the turnover was. But having said that, say our turnover when we go into League One, get back there, is 10 million. Our turnover is 10 million. Our sales are 10 million. Just say that. It might actually be a bit more than that, maybe 12, based on what we're doing now. And so we go up out of League One and we go into the Championship. Now, the team that's gone up into the Premier League has come bottom of the Premier League and comes out of the Premier League. Bear in mind, our turnover is 10 to 12 million. Turnover, not profit, turnover is 10 to 12 million. That club that's just gone up to the Premier League, comes down, plays against us the next season, gets about 170 million for coming bottom of the Premier League. Forgetting everything else, that's just from the television monies. So all of a sudden you've got a massive differential in there. And that's one of the problems in the game. But actually, you know, so your business plan's got to change a little bit. So copying them isn't necessarily what we want to do. You know, you look at what they do, you look at what they do on merchandising, but actually living with them is a different thing. So, you know, we're talking about getting a pre-season. We had Liverpool over for a pre-season last year. They've helped us in any number of ways. They're under-23s play at Tranmere, and we make money out of that, etc., even though the pitch does get hammered, but actually it's enabled us to invest in the pitch to make sure it doesn't show, etc. So there's a relationship with Liverpool. We wouldn't slavishly follow them. It's a different animal. It's there, 2 o'clock. Right.
Yeah, one second. Can you tell us a little bit about sort of what it means to be a sport industry professional, you know, sort of the type of staff?
Sorry?
The type of staff that you'd want working for you, what it means to be a professional,
yeah,
for you.
The playing staff I'd like working for me would be Coutinho, Mane. I think there's some good news and some bad news about working in sport. And the first bit, it's a privilege to work in the sport. In any aspect of sport, I think it's a real privilege. But then I'm a sports nut in a sense. It's done a, you know, great deal for me in my life. And I just think it unlocks so much. So it's a privilege to work in sport, and with the benefit comes the burden. As a consequence of that, it's quite difficult to get in. And the question is, how do you do that? And then once you're in, how do you stay in there? So how do you get in? Well, the first thing is that when you write in, it's quite simple stuff, really. Writing good English. Because I tell you what, I'm not a grammar, well, my daughter say I'm a grammar Nazi, but if you wrote to me, I'd immediately, whatever you say, I'd immediately start to pigeonhole you as poorly educated. Now, whatever that means, because education isn't everything, you know. But the problem is, there's so many people trying to get in, that it's the small things that make a difference. So if you put apostrophe in the wrong place, I'm not going to test you, but you put an apostrophe in the wrong place, and I'll pick it up. And you might say, well, everybody else aren't like you. But I tell you what, you've got to assume that they are. You've gone red because you don't know what where apostrophes go, do you? Right. Oh, look, I can test you. No, but the point I'm making is that the small things make a difference, because you know, it's like my daughter's trying to get into a legal firm. So many people trying to do that. And, you know, some of the stuff's really unfair, the way they filter you. And so you're getting filtered from day one, and everybody's at it to get into sport. It doesn't matter what it is. And so that's just a, you know, your letter's important. Your first contact is important. It's polite. It's not unreasonable. It's not saying you're the best thing since sliced bread, because with all due respect, age 21, if you tell me that you've turned around, you know, ICI, you know, and I see this in the professions as much as in sport, You're not going to kid anybody. There's a limit to what your experience is. So you've got to be realistic. And I would say one of the biggest things in life is having EQ, emotional quotient, not IQ. IQ is a commodity. I can buy that tomorrow. EQ is massively important. And your EQ starts from your first contact with an organisation. EQ is emotional quotient. It's me sitting here thinking, what are you thinking? And you're thinking, why the is he looking at me? But it is, it's that ability to be on the other side of the desk. And if I could give any kid anything, I'd give them that. And so when you're writing in, you're writing in to somebody and saying, well, is he busy? You know, do I want to get to the point? Do I want to say succinctly, it's this, 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 and this? Do I want to be modest? Do I want to also display a little bit of what I've got? Because your very letter starts to get that in terms of a message to the person who's picking it up and reading it. Because I'm not saying that's going to rule you out, but why take a chance when you can get that right? You know, and if you can't write, if you don't know what an apostrophe means, why don't you get it checked out with somebody? Preferably learn, because hopefully you're not just going to write one letter. But why don't you just test it? Because I tell you what, it is massively important. That's your first impression. Not when you walk through the door, that's your first impression. Be realistic. Know a little bit about the place. I was speaking to a lad who was out working in China with my daughter, and he came back and he was going to try and get a job. I call him a green ninja. He works in the green element of business. And he said he was having difficulty getting a job. And he then said he was going to, he was going to apply to this business and that business and this business. And he said, but he's really hopeful about this business. And I went, okay, what's the turnover of the business? He looked at me as though I was from a different planet. I said, you know, is it a PLC? Is it a private company? How many employees they've got? What's the name of the chief exec? Very simple in this day and age of the information superhighway, or the internet as they call it now. You can find that out tomorrow. So do some research on the thing. Don't just turn up, because that's another black mark immediately. It's because I'll ask you something about, well, you know, where do you think we were last year and at the club, etc. You know, where does British judo fit in the scheme of things? How many medals did we get at the Olympics last year? So do some research, you know, because that's expected of you. You don't need to display that in your letter, but when you turn up, you should have that. So it's a privilege to work in it, but how do you get into it? It's quite difficult, and it's hard to get jobs. There's good news and there's bad news. But once you're in, you've got to stay in it. And I would say that in terms of good news and bad news, there's no standard career path is the bad news. There isn't a standard career path. You know, I was a chartered accountant, so yeah, I qualified as a chartered accountant doing my exams. I went and worked in a firm. I got work experience, etc. If I'm a lawyer, same thing. If I'm a doctor, same thing. If I'm a dentist, same thing. So you have to accept that there's no standard career path. And that tells me two things. One is you've got to be flexible, which I'll come back to. And two is that there are three types of accountant. Those that can count and those that can't. I can't remember what the second thing is now. There's no standard career path. There's no training. There's no continual professions education. So you've got to be flexible. You've got to take what comes and you've got to make the most of it. And if I give you an example, there's a lad, I just left a meeting again today. There's a lad who came to me, and again, you should use your network of contacts to the extent that you can. He is actually one of my best mate's sons, and you say, oh, nepotism. But actually, I wouldn't take anybody on that doesn't add any value. I know the lad, and he's a good lad. He's a self-starter, so if I'm looking at his CV, he's gone out to China, and he's been taught Mandarin at university in China, and then come back. He's done Spanish as well, so he's a linguist. But he came to me and he was really keen on getting involved in the digital stuff around looking after professional players. So agents will actually say, you know, you're whoever, Coutinho, I'm going to be your agent, but I'm going to develop you as a brand, and I'm going to develop, you know, I'm going to look after all your tweets, look after all your Twitter. I don't know if it does Joey Barton's, but he needs a lesson himself. And develop you as a player, as a brand. And that's what he was going to do. And that's what he ain't doing that at Tranmere. He came along, but he's asked to stay. I've given him a 6-month contract. He'll probably stay beyond that. And what he's been doing since he's been with us is recruiting teachers to send out to China, recruiting coaches, writing the curriculum for the international school that we've got. And he worked on some of the community stuff that we did in terms of the college. So he was flexible. But above all, he was useful. You know, make yourself useful. Make yourself indispensable. Just how does that happen? Well, actually, there's a balance between going back and constantly asking, and that's one of your biggest difficulties when you go in. You will not have experience, and therefore you've got to ask questions, because if you don't ask questions, you haven't got experience. I can feel a disaster coming along. So how do you do that? Find the person in the organisation that you can quietly go to and not pester him. And actually, I did it when I was an accountant. When I started out, I didn't know a debit from a credit, etc. But I found people in the organisation, and I wouldn't find one, I'd find about four. So I wouldn't be pestering one. And you may say, well, that's... No, honestly, it's massively important, because you've got to ask questions to learn. Because if I talk to you about a dangling debit, you wouldn't have a clue what that was. If I talk to you about, I want you to go out and I want you to do the curriculum for a Chinese school in Ho Hot that we're going to develop, you can look at me, where would you start? Well, you'd start by going to speak to, I'll give you a bit of heads up as to where you want to go and who you want to speak to, but that's what he's going to do. And then he brings it back, and he brings it back with the caveats, and he's thought about it, and he's worked on it. And he hasn't just said, well, actually, that's 9 to 5, that's it. So I think that, you know, in terms of the major thing is, whatever you go into, you've got to be prepared to be flexible and work around and make yourself useful. There aren't standard career paths to train you. So the negative is, there's no standard career path. It's hard to get in, but it's great once you're in, and how do you keep that? The really good news for you lot, the really good news, everybody picks up now, the really good news is that in my experience, and it may be that it's passing, but a lot of the people you deal with are not rocket scientists. So it is a question of being the tallest dwarf, if that's politically correct. You only have to be better than the next person. So the people you're going to compete against ain't going to be that good. It may be changing, and your generation may be coming in much more motivated towards that, and therefore you've got your peer pressure and you've got to compete. But the downside for you on that is the people above you will have been from the previous generation. They aren't necessarily the best. Now, you've got to use your EQ here, because you've got to get the balance right when you know you're working for somebody who you may not respect. But the reality is they've got masses of experience, and that sport for me is stuffed with that. And so I look at it and look at the kids and think, well, you know, if I was in PwC, I've got a very formal structure within which I can be trained. And they'll train you in this, they'll train you in that. You've got a good guy you can go to. You've got a whole plethora of people you can go to and trust. It isn't the same in sport. And if I go back from football and I go into Olympic sport and I look at that, and there is it's almost like a hologram. There's a whole host of positions in Olympic sport. The people aren't very good quality. Financial directors, chief executives. And these businesses aren't really businesses where you get quality FDs, legal. But they put them all in place because we think we must have that. And if I had my way, I'd actually strip them all out and do it centrally for all the support functions. Because I think the quality of the FDs, the quality of the chief execs, the quality of the HR directors, the quality of the lawyers is not that good. But for me, coming in at your age, there's a big caveat. Who do you go to? Who do you deal with? And you've just got to get your EQ right and be sure that you're going through the political minefield in that particular organisation, because there will be one. And there's nothing worse when you've got an organisation and some of those guys in that area, I'm generalising massively, but some of those guys in that area aren't the best. And you think, actually, well, I know if I had his years of experience, I'd be better than him. You've got to play that carefully. And just a warning. But the good side to it is the cream will rise to the top, you know. So have confidence in your own abilities. And just some quick standard career tips, if I can. Get another string to your bow. Dead simple. You know. What are you when you go in? Are you a generalist? You know, can you get something else? Can you go and do a bit of work somewhere else first and then come back? Can you become an accountant? Can you become a lawyer? Can you become do some HR? Get some in-depth experience that just gives you a little bit of an edge. this is standard career advice. Can you do the job? You know, have you just turned up and somebody's offered you a job at Liverpool Football Club? You don't really know what it is. You don't really know whether you can do the job. And so many people I see doing that, they just turn up and they think, well, they haven't really thought about being able to do the job. It's probably a bit more when you're a bit more senior that you do that. Is the organisation set up to allow you to deliver that? And there's an argument that, you know, a chief exec of the FA, it's the impossible job. You can't do it because the way the organisation is set up and the structure with the Premier League, etc. So that's just a generalisation on that one. There's a very important one for me. Are you still learning? Every year, from when I was about 29, I used to write down at the end of the year, and I make my daughters do this at the end of every month, what have I learnt? You've got to be honest with yourself. And this is particularly in sport because there's a phrase we use, which is, well, it's too crude to use here, but it's basically like moth to a flame. And people will come in and, you know, when you're at the FA, everybody wants to see, in those days, Sven and David Beckham, and they all gravitate towards England. Well, actually, the reality is you've got a job to do over here. You know, and even in Tranmere, you know, they'll gravitate towards the first team, and but you've got a job to do here. So it's a nice place to be, and I think I forget what the percentage turnover rate was for people at the FA, but the HR director came into me on the first week and said, look, we have a minimal staff turnover. It's great. And I said, no, it's not. Because they're all in it. They love being there. It's great when you go to a party. So what do you do as a job? I'm a chartered accountant. Turn away. What do you do as a job? Well, work at the FA and they'll start and speak to you. So there's all kinds of things like this that make it attractive for you to stay in the job. But the real question you should ask yourself is, am I still learning? You know, have I learnt anything at the end of the year? What have I learnt this year? And that's a massive, it's not just for this, it's for whatever you do. And I just, you know, I'm 64, so I can say that to you. An interesting thing I've also got, when it feels like a job that you're doing, leave it. Because, you know, you're not on this cliff to just have a job. And that's just a small piece of advice for me that I think, again, I've walked away from jobs at the end of the day once it felt like a job. And it just, with checking how much I was learning, I was still always on the go and moving and changing and doing things. but the caveat to that is that you've got to spend enough time to make something stick. Because if I'm looking at your CV, and I see, one of the things I do with every CV, so well, how long was he in that job? He's moving every 12 months or 6 months. And I'll ask you when you come in, why did you move from there to there? What was your reason for moving? So you've got to make sure that when you move to something better, you move for a positive reason, and you can argue that reason because your CV will be looked at. One thing I did see in the notes before I came here was you're looking at LinkedIn. And how many people use LinkedIn here?
We've got a session on it next week.
Yeah, I hate it, but I'll tell you something now, it's useful. We got our chief operating officer, he was at Liverpool. I mean, it's too late for me in terms of LinkedIn, and it's just a pain because everybody keeps trying to join me into LinkedIn. I don't want to join into them, but, you know, so, but he 6 months after we came in, I got a LinkedIn, my wife got a LinkedIn message from a guy called Peter Shaw, who was at Liverpool. And I looked at it and said, well, just like he won't want to come here and we can't pay him enough and da-da. Anyway, he persevered and he's now the chief operating officer of the club and he's been responsible for a lot of the good stuff that I've talked about. You know, so for me, things like that, LinkedIn, are important and, you know, you'll be told how to use it going forwards. Two pieces of advice from an old man. First thing is ask for no quarter and give no quarter. When I played football and I was doing chartered accountancy at the same time, which is unusual, I used to work during the day, train myself every night, and I used to turn up for games. If I actually didn't get on the end of a cross, you know, I couldn't say to the fans, sorry, I've been working all week and I've been studying for exams, and I was just a bit knackered. And equally, if I'd been down the other end of the country, as I did one day playing at Gillingham, I ended up in A&E getting stitches in my face, and I turn up at 8:30 the following morning having travelled back up with supporters because the team was staying over, and I had an 8:30 meeting with a guy who wanted tax advice. He'd come in and have a big black eye and stitches, and for about 2 minutes that would be interesting to him. And he'd say, how'd you do that? Oh yeah, see you scored last night, yeah. And then he'd want his advice, and I had to be prepared for his advice. And so my attitude was ask no quarter, give no quarter. So, you know, you haven't done something, whatever it is, you've been asked to do something, put a PR campaign together. I've had the flu or I've been ill. I was ill last night, I was up all night. No. And that may be me, but I mean, I just think it's a thing to hold. You know, clearly if you're really ill and stuff, you can't turn up, but it's that attitude that don't make excuses, you know, just do it and do it to the best of your ability. So ask for no quarter, give no quarter. But above all, you know, I can't recommend a career better than being in sport. I mean, my career really wasn't in sport. For most of my time, I was out as a chartered accountant between finishing football at 34 and going back to the FA at 50. And for me, it's a fantastic career.